I'm not going to stay out here much longer. It hailed a little bit a while ago, and now it's raining very hard. Winter has finally come to Jerusalem.
Hi, welcome to Biblical Explorations. Today I'm going to take a look at the first verse in Genesis. We've got here the first word of the first verse, Bereshit. This is Be, Re. This is an Aleph, which is a vowel placeholder, basically. It can have several different sounds. Sheet. So, Bereshit. Read the whole verse. Bereshit, Bara, Elohim, Et, Hashemayim, Va'et, Ha'eretz. Now, take a look at this step by step. The Bible begins with this particle, B, and it means, as you can see at the bottom of the computer screen in the little window that kind of gives you verbal and grammatical and dictionary meanings for the terms. You can see the B there is a particle. Rashit means... It comes from the term Rosh in Hebrew. It means head, literally, but Rashit means the top, the beginning, the first. So, at the first might be one way to translate this. In the beginning is the typical way. But the in the beginning phrase, in fact, derives not so much from the Hebrew itself, but from the Latin, in principio, which is very accurately translated as in the beginning. The Greek, on the other hand, translates, again, a little bit differently. And arche means, arche, beginning, first, principle, ruler, all sorts of different things. Kind of the olden days, our term archaeology derives from this. So, you know, in olden times, at the beginning, in the beginning, at the first, something along those lines is what it means. Now, the traditional English translation has been in the beginning. And, which is pretty good. But notice that the New Revised Standard Version adds when, in the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth. Now, this is a very interesting question because the issue arises, is it the beginning of everything? Is the book of Genesis here with Bereshit describing the beginning of everything, or is it the beginning of God making, creating the heavens and the earth? It's an interesting question because the next verse kind of implies that there's some things there. But at any rate, it says in the beginning and then bara, which means, as you can see, create. It's a verb in Hebrew that is related to basically divine action. It's used mainly about God making things, but it doesn't necessarily mean to bring out of nothing, but it means to form. And to create in all sorts of different ways. We can take a look here in the dictionary, and my wonderful Accordance program has this dictionary window that comes up, and you can see bara here. We'll make the screen a little bit bigger so that you can see it a little better. Bara. So notice that bara here means to create and is linked mainly with God. So, for example, God creates the heavens and the earth in Genesis. In Isaiah, he creates the ends of the earth. But he can also create, for example, wind, clouds, and darkness. So notice, he doesn't always create out of nothing. He can create wind, which, you know, is something that in a sense exists, but he's making it come into being. He also creates salvation. He can create people. It can be used also for a clean heart, notice, so something metaphorical. Anyway, that's pretty interesting term there, but it's basically to create, to make, to build, notice, might be that type of thing, and is related mainly to God. Now, in Greek, we get the term epoiesen, which means to do or to make or to work, but it's quite a different conceptualization than is bara. It it, you know, it can be a much broader thing. You can do a job, you can work at farming, that type of thing. Also, in Latin, it's creavit, which from which our create derives, our term create, which you can see here in the English version. But creavit is the Latin idea, to make or create. So the different conceptualizations in Greek here, in Latin here, and in Hebrew are overlapping, but not exactly the same. And that's an important idea to think about, that no word in Hebrew, such as bara, can be precisely translated into any other language.